confusing me greatly. But welcome, guys. FTD Club B up against Vici Gaming here, and it's best of two for the Manila Qualifiers Chinese group stage. Yes, you heard me right. I said best of two. Scat. I'm using it now. I'm using it. We've accepted it as nomenclature in Dota 2. Best of two is what we're going for. The bans so far, Alchemist, Bounty, and Beastmaster. And I was talking to Nahas. We had a bit of a chat yesterday. While we were watching a few open qualifier games and just sort of, you know, shooting the shit and talking about heroes, I said that Alchemist is going to be like first phase ban material. Just because we've seen Southeast Asian and Chinese teams run, like you were mentioning a couple of weeks ago, the kind of manipulation of net worth or manipulation of like gold income strat with Bounty and Alchemist, and both of them by Vici, but also with like just Aghanims being added to the game. Always increases the value of Alchemist, right? And this build where you go Armlet Radiance and you can just farm into these bigger, better items. He's a great battling hero early on. He gets you over that initial hump of like 20 minutes or so and gets you past the hump into the Aghanims for like your supports, like your Disruptor, your Vengeful Spirit and stuff like that.
Yep, I agree with you. Alchemist is a very big deal right now. And I feel like if you look at the previous Alchemist before it got nerfed, it was kind of on this trajectory where people were learning, okay, this is how we draft against Alchemist, this is how we shut it down, this is how we keep ganking it. And then it got nerfed, and people kind of forgot about it. And then I feel like it undoes a lot of that work that you did developing ways to deal with the hero. And so for a while now, while Alchemist gets picked, it's going to seem very difficult to deal with for a lot of teams. And the funny thing for me in this game is Vici ban up the Ulk and the Bounty, and then they first pick the Doom. And I think these are like the only three heroes Vici in the game that just generate economy out of nothing. So they're like, well, we take out two of them, we'll pick the wine, and we're the only team that's going to be getting bonus gold this game.
It's a weird thing, right? Just getting this gold from apparently nowhere. But FTD.B, this lineup, we've got a couple of recognizable names, right? There's Pretty Whore and there's Triple S. These two guys have been around for a little bit, but coming back onto this team, switching things up a touch. Pretty Whore's been playing a ton of Chen, so great ban out by Vici Gaming there, getting rid of his Chen, because that's been like a linchpin hero for FTD so far. But this Batrider that they've got, I've seen a lot of mid Batrider recently in Europe and Southeast Asia, but they still do like to run in the offlane from time to time, give it over to Ran.
Yeah. I mean, we should be clear to start with. These are probably the two big underdogs of the qualifier. I mean, it's certainly of their group. Vici Gaming came through the open qualifier. FTD Club, a team that got directly invited, but I think a lot of people would have expected to come through the open qualifier. They had to go through open qualifier for Frankfurt, where they did make it into the qualifier. For Shanghai, they didn't actually get through the open qualifier. For the Shanghai Dota Open, which is a China-only tournament, they didn't even get through the open qualifier. So this is a team that's recently, they've had a few good performances in Edge Cup. One of the editions of Edge Cup, they actually made the top four, I think. And so that's kind of like driven them forward and got them that direct invite to these qualifiers. But they're certainly still big underdogs in the scene, as are Vici Gaming. I think neither of these teams have actually registered a win yet in this tournament. I think Vici's got 2-0-2s and FTD Club have 1-0-2, if I'm correct. So this is, I mean, look, either way, there's an opportunity to turn things around, win the rest of your games now, get out of the group stage. But the story for me coming in here is kind of like marking territory as like, hey, you're the new kid on the block, not us. You're the ones going to get beaten down, not us. And I want to see which team it is that's giving the beating.
That's the thing, with Vici Gaming having such high profile and expensive and valuable players, you know, burning Sila, they've got a lot of money behind them in the contracts that are kind of thrown around in China. It feels more of a necessity here for VG. Like, they need to win, they need to prove that they're worth the values that have been assigned to them or have been set by the companies or organizations buying them and signing them up. And if they don't prove themselves and, you know, qualify for the major, what's the next step for them? Do they go back to streaming? Do they continue trying to play? Do they create new teams? Do they split up? This is, I feel like, a make or break point from Vici. And it's the scariest thing is it's early days, right? This is a relatively new squad that was founded, you know, a month or two ago with the addition of Sylar. The rest of them being around for a while. They took out JDH for Sylar, but they kept RTK, HYM, CTY, and Burning. If they lose this game, like, it's not just this tournament, it's not just this qualifier, but this game is like a pivotal moment. Like you said, they're 0-4 in the group stage right now. They've lost two of their best of twos. This is as good a time as any to show your worth.
If they were to lose 0-2 here, then I feel like they can't get out of the group anymore. I mean, I haven't checked mathematically, but I think losing three matches 0-2 is probably, yeah, that's it.
It's not good. It's definitely not good. Turn
to pick. So, yeah, I mean, also, this is supposed to be the easiest match they're going to have in the entire group stage, as far as they're concerned. So now's the time to actually show they're capable of getting those wins. And I agree with you. I think that if this qualifies a flop for Vici Gaming, this team is probably going to make more changes. I mean, they already have to go through open qualifiers when it comes to TI, because they've already made a change that affected this roster lock, which applies to both the Manila Major and TI. So there wouldn't really be any incentive for them not to change things around. And maybe the pressure to some extent is on HYM in this team, because he's the only one who doesn't have the huge all-star credentials from...
There's like no pedigree.
Yeah, I mean, he played a little bit for HGT before joining this team, but he's not a well-known player. At the same time, I feel like, for me, the trouble with this Vici Gaming team might be more about the other players than about the non-pedigree player, about the fact that there's too many superstars with, like, big demands and big egos, and that's the thing I like about CDEC, actually, that they have, like, kind of rabbits, and then these four, like, veteran leader people to play around them, whereas Vici Gaming they've got ROTK, who's known for leadership skills, but CTY, Silo, and Burning are all meant to be kind of play-around, I'm the most important person in the team kind of players, and they're all in one team.
That's why coming into this game and coming into watching games of VG, I'm always looking for, like, you know, a Silo anti-mage, and then watching Burning support and feel the pain of when you have to give up so much and be so sacrificial to your one role carry. But in this game, it looks like VG a little more aggressive on the uptake here. Lifestealer, Puck, Lion, Doom. I got that Lifestealer Infest Bomb with the Puck there once you get to Blink Dagger up and running. But early game aggression, and also pretty good heroes against this Lone Druid. Lifestealer always touted as that kind of anti-Lone Druid hero with the Feasts and the Open Wounds. Of pain, susceptible to nuke and burst damage. We're going to have that really cool 1v1 matchup between her and the Puck. But the Batrider, actually, are they going to run the safe lane Queen of Pain? They have done that in the past, actually. Batrider mid, Lone Druid off lane, safe lane Queen of Pain is an option here. FTD could actually mix things up.
I think you don't really like offlaning Lone Druid against a Lifestealer, though, as you were saying. I think Lifesteal does quite well there and threatens to kill as well. Plus, you can just chomp at the Spirit Bear when it tries to farm, so... If it wasn't for that, I think I'd agree with you that this might be an opportunity to mix things up. But just because of the Lifestealer pick, if I were FTD, I'd be just planning for standard laning here with the Bath in the off lane and the Lone Druid in the safe lane.
Even the Lifestealer does well against Batrider, having that rage to get rid of the sticky napalm stacks. And the main reason I say this is because of the way they've played their heroes previously and the kind of role attributions they've had. The majority of the time, DXM plays the Batrider towards the mid lane, and Triple S plays like Queen of Pain safe lane. So that would leave, for me, the offlane Lone Druid for Ran, and it looks like that's the way it's going. But of course, you know, players can still swap lanes depending on how their captain wants it. But, you know, Pretty Horn, the Vengeful Spirit, and Ping over on the Nightstalker there, while Vici Gaming, CTY, Puck, Lifestealer, HYM, Oracle, Burning on the Lion, I'm guessing, and ROTK. Offlane Doom is something I want to pick your brain about, because we saw a lot of 4-roll Doom in Europe, Puppy had all Tranquil's Buckle of Lads build. China still love this, like, raw offlane Doom.
Yeah, I think Doom's a fantastic hero. It's great in 4 position, it's also great in offlane. In some ways, offlane Doom is just a less greedy version of 4 position Doom. Because the way you play the game is quite similar to the 4 position Doom. A lot of time you do death the jungle, a lot of the time you do make those early rotations, but you're not stretching your team when you do it, because, you know, you're the offlaner, there's still 2 supports. So I just feel like it's a slightly less greedy version of the same thing, and yeah, I can definitely get behind that, especially in a strategy where you're trying to go for Lifestealer and Pack Bombs. You don't want to then also be a greedy draft, like, commit to what you're doing. They're trying to be aggressive, that's what Vici Gaming want to do in this game. For me, speaking of that aggression, I'm always interested, especially in the last 2 patches, at looking at the sort of early laning stage, first 5-6 minutes of the game. And what's interesting in this game, I've seen it once or twice, and this is always my comment, Nightstalker and Vengeful Spirit support combo on the side of FTD. This is actually a support combo that I think is pretty weak at the beginning of the game. Like, there's no long-range hero for zonal harassing. They don't really threaten a kill that efficiently. I mean, it's possible. They can set up a kill with their nuke and their stun. But really, they want to get into that roaming part of the game, where one of them roaming onto lane can make a kill, or where Nightstalker has knights. So, I feel like the first, like, pre-knights part of the game is pretty favorable for Vici Gaming in the lane stage, just because of the support duo picked on FTD.
Yeah, I'd agree with you, because especially when Nightstalker needs that kind of ramp up time and needs to be sitting in the jungle for the first 3.5 minutes, get himself to level 3 at the very least. Sometimes we see from CIS teams the boots first over on the Nightstalker, just run yourself around a little bit here. Ping just going to block things up over towards there. Now, on Dota 2 Lounge, FTD against VG is still not active. I guess we start a little bit early. A little bit. Excellent. Just thought I'd poke you. Just thought I'd poke you a little bit. Let's see, yeah, game number one of the best of two. Let's have a look at these lanes. So Safe Lock going to pay in like a call for Triple S there, with a Vengeful Spirit supporting against for now anyway. HYM Oracle and RGK on that Doombringer. Towards the middle lane. CY playing the puck against DXM Batrider, and this matchup's going to be relatively fun to watch. The Sticky Napalm obviously going to start stacking up. CTY keeps himself a little bit further away at bay from the Batrider's aggressive play. But offlane, this is where the danger is for the Lone Druid. Ran is in a 1v2 against Lion and Lifestealer, and without the help of any support, there's no one to come and heal him or save him. He does have a pretty difficult position to play into, while CTY just dodging through these projectiles thrown by DXM. Simple stuff so far for them. But VG, their lanes look strong, but how can they progress from lanes into actually fighting into heroes like the Bat, like the Queen of Pain?
Well, I mean, the real point is that if their lane stage goes well and they've got like a level advantage and an early item advantage, then they get to shut down the Nightstalker's first night. And from there, it kind of like, it snowballs into, there's never a stage where FTD get their like breakout, we're not taking control of the game. It's about the Nightstalker's first night, it's about the Batrider getting blink, and what do those timings look like? Do FTD have space to gain momentum when they hit those timings? Because if they don't, they're going to be trouble. And I mean, I spoke about the Venge and Nightstalker's support combo, but what Vici Gaming have done here, sending the Oracle up top, it's actually really smart. They sense the Nightstalker will be in the jungle. The Queen of Pain only has Venge supporting. Venge, by the way, because the Nightstalker wants to start with Iron Talon, it's just Sentry Wards and Tangos. She has two Tangos and a pair of Sentry Wards. She also bought Wards and Crit, and this is like, this Vengeful Spirit cannot really contribute to the lane. Like, she's there in case they dive onto the Queen of Pain to help out in those situations, but the lane's going to be perfectly contested by Vici Gaming, and the moment's just kind of even trade. Initially, the Queen of Pain was actually not even getting farmed at all, but once the lane pushed, she got a bunch of the CS money.
And then you kind of look at the progression through from VG, right? Because RTK is going to get his Doom relatively soon. He's in this offlane with the help of Oracle. The Puck's going to get, obviously, into level 6, level 7 with the nuke damage and the silences there as well. So Triple S, this Queen of Pain, we used to see it a lot from Chinese teams, especially early first quarter last year was safe lane Queen of Pain rushing the Orchid. Brown boots into Orchid, you'd play aggressively, you'd run around the map, cause a bunch of havoc and chaos, and just pick off kills. But against the Doombringer here, who's going to be pretty much always targeting the Queen of Pain, I feel. As long as she hasn't blinked in and Sonic Waved, RGK is going to have eyes set dead on this Triple S Queen of Pain. I'm looking for that Doom, and that's just going to remove your safe lane hero from the game. No spells, no nothing. While Sylar, he's been free farming bottom lane. So about to pick up the Spirit Bear down here, and that's 300 gold, 300 experience split between the two of them. Burning gets a ton of cash, and that's almost as good as a hero kill.
That's why you don't run offlane Lone Druid against Lifestealer, because you're usually putting either your bear or yourself at risk of dying. Well, okay, Oracle found Nightstalker in the jungle, and it was bad timing for him because he was pretty low. So that's him going down, and the Oracle wants to move towards the mid lane now, but this is, I think, fair predictable, yeah. So you're gonna pull away, not gonna go for the greed there. But Triple S, by the way, I think he's the one who started. Do you remember last year there was a stage where for a while Queen of Pains were buying Shadow Blade in China?
Yeah.
And I think he actually started that. So I don't know.
Oh, Ram. One more hit. Is it enough? It is, even with a Savage Roar. VG gets the kill on the Lone Druid. Good stuff. But Triple S, what was the team he was playing for?
It's difficult for me to remember now.
It wasn't Vici Reborn, was it?
I think it was Vici, yeah. Vici, what they called Vici Potential.
Potential, okay.
Yeah, I think that's what it was, yeah.
Yeah, there was a bunch of players that came from, like, the VP game tournament that we'd never really heard of before that played this Queen of Pain. What was it? It wasn't Rush into Shadowblade, it was like Orchid Shadowblade, right?
Yeah. Like Zek Knights and Shadowblade. And then ZYF started doing it, and then it became popular for a while, and then it just kind of disappeared. Never really hit the international scene at all. The nice thing about it was that you could kind of Shadowblade in, then you have your blink to disengage, or other way around, or... It is actually nighttime now, so let's see. Nightstalker has managed to get up to level 4, does have boots, and this is meant to be the first window in the game that favors FTD. But as of yet, doesn't look like they think they can get much out of this. I mean, if they get onto the Oracle with the Nightstalker, silence, slow, stun, they'd probably kill the Oracle. Doom's gonna be much more difficult though. So it's about HYM's positioning.
Can Nightstalker get in there though? That's the big question. Actually finding the loop in and wrap around onto HYM, the easier target is the Oracle, and FTDB, they're gonna go look for this. HYM, he's all on his lonesome. And the nuke damage out from Pretty Whore and Ping, they're gonna right click him down. RTK tries to get in here with the Scorched Earth and the Infernal Blade, but Burning's TP'd in for the counterplay. Pretty Whore's hexed up, blasted down by that Santa Blast from RTK, and now he's turning back onto the Queen of Pain, but the Shadow Strike comes down onto Burning, and just punched down to the ground by the Nightstalker. A double kill for Ping. And the further aggression here from VG, trying to TP in to save that situation, but middle DXM dies to the invest. Solo finds the kill mid lane. They don't TP mid, they actually fight into, they don't TP top, they fight in towards the mid, where back kill off CTY and Sylar comes in to try and save the day.
Okay, so the game is becoming action-packed at the first night, which is kind of what we expect. FTD needs to do that to contest the game. It's interesting that, I mean, for Vici's sake, they're trading evenly for now. It's a top lane, I think HYM's dead again.
Oh, you're right.
Duke
drops as well. The pop. Jaunting forwards, Dream Coil not ready. 27 seconds, there's no chance this comes up before the team fight concludes. With Pretty Whore retreating out, they'll actually turn and stun RTK, but the Batrider coming in, they've got Firefly, they've got the Lasso, they've got Napalm stacked up on CTY, he's got no orb, he's got no way to get himself out of here! He finally jumps himself a little bit further away, back to safety, but RTK's gonna lose his life for that one. CTY, stuck under his own tier 1 as DXM, he wants to dive in for this, but Burning misses the Impale. Oh, the Lion maybe could have found a kill onto the Batrider there with the help of Puck, but VG, they're being run over a little bit here in his first nighttime, like you're saying.
And they've got to be a little bit careful because, you know, I think their motivation here is they recognize this is a window for FTD. They don't just sit back and give them that momentum. But at the same time, if you come out and face them every time going for these fights, you risk the possibility of giving them more than just what they want. You know, like, if they're getting one pick off here and there, that's one thing. But if you keep sending all your heroes and giving them lots of kills, that gives them much more of the momentum that they're actually looking for. So there's kind of two approaches for Vici here. You can try and avoid the ganks, get some farm, or if you take the fights, you need to be more prepared to actually take them.
Well, CTY is going to stick himself up the top lane for now. He's had enough of that mid lane Batrider being an absolute pain in the backside. But Nightstalker, Tranquil Boots, Windlace, Iron Talon, more movement speed than God right now. Bringing himself around the map. I wonder what he goes into. Whether he goes for the drums with the Windlace, or is that just going to be a casual item for him? Because right now, he has 6 item slots filled with very, very small kind of incremental items that don't build up into too much big.
Yeah, and this is actually one of the problems with the new patch is so many... I mean, he doesn't even have raindrops, right? He doesn't have I always forget the armor reduction. Blightstone?
Blightstone, like, yeah.
There's so many little gadgets that are useful for supports to buy that sometimes you get tempted to buying all of them and then, like, you don't have space for a TP scroll, which is kind of where he was there. If he's holding wards, he's kind of a TP. So it's something that I think going forward into the patch, people are going to sort of start prioritizing, like, these two small items on these heroes. Well, mid lane, there's an initiation onto bat.
CTY thinks he can go for this, but DXM finger at death from Burning, there we go, that's what CTY was waiting for. DXM didn't know what hit him, but looking at the Batrider and seeing him now, Boots of Travel as your primary item for the mid-bat. And we've seen this a little bit recently, going for like Hand of Midas or BOTs. They're going to dive into the poor little Vengeful Spirit, and she is absolutely screwed over under her own tier 1. But yeah, the BOTs slash Midas, the kind of maybe more farming-focused item on the Batrider from the mid lane. And then you build up into your Blink Dagger and you've got 2 or 3 items instead of just the one. So it creates kind of leeway for yourself. If you don't utilize the Blink and don't get kills and pickoffs, then it can be, you know, not a wasted item, but it's not going to be as effective as maybe the Boots of Travel will definitely be.
Yeah, I'm a little bit worried for FTD now because Bat really needs that Blink because that's their main tool for getting pickoffs on the Lifestealer or controlling the Lifestealer if fights come. And Lifestealer is, this hero is peaking right now.
Oh man, Armlet, Phase, Sylar. When you get the blink up on CTY, which is 700 gold away, that's when you're going to start seeing the big jumps in from VG. But I think it's smoke time for FTD. They will get themselves around the tier 2 tools mid, triple S, pretty whore on pink. Where are they going to though? Because Lion is the only one that's kind of shown himself on bottom lane. He flashed a little bit, he's now pulled across. There's no one showing mid. There's only the Oracle and Doom showing top, and even RTK is hiding away. So obviously natural position to gank into is this Radiant jungle. Look for the Lifestealer, look for someone who's farming here. But they're not going to find anyone. This is great from VG actually hiding off the map. Burning has again flashed himself on bottom lane. He's the only target they can go for, and they have to. They have to make the smoke worthwhile. The stuns will come through and Burning will drop. And I've got to turn this into a tier 1 though, because the rest of their lanes being pressured pretty hard here by the rest of VG. Poor Burning. Actually, no, not poor Burning. Bloody rich Burning. 1800 gold on that Lion. Scant. They're gonna have double blink soon. Puck and Lion and that Lifestealer being able to infest into either one of them. Oh, RTK walks himself back past the lane. Looks like he's going to go into the drums. Tank yourself up and pad out those stats as much as you can. There's the first blink dagger up for VG. They do take that tier 1 up at top lane. Lone Druid, how's he doing? Sitting on his hand of Midas, 1,000 gold. And this is something we haven't really looked at or talked about. Is this Radiance on the Lone Druid and the timing on this one? And when we see it, yeah, usually they're kind of 20-minute offlane Radiance for the Lone Druid. You get into like 25-minute Vlads, you get your AC a little bit later, and you kind of just stack up item after item. But it's the lane push, it's the presence of the Spirit Bearer in the early stages. As soon as that Radiance hits, mischance up against the Lifestealer, against the Puck, is pretty good. But you've got this Rage from Lifestealer, able to actually just rip through the Bear as much as he possibly can. The Doom from RGK's Doombringer, thrown down onto a hero like the Queen of Pain. And FTDB, they might be relying a little bit on this Radiance too much, giving him a lot of farm priority. But Batrider and Queen of Pain, if any heroes are, these heroes are space creators. And they can jump themselves around the map, catch people guard, get kills on important heroes. With the Sonic Wave being pure and piercing that magic immunity, Syla does have to be wary with his armlet toggling and his rage timing. Keep that infest, either for a bomb in with a Puck to catch someone out, or keep it for your safe retreat away from the Queen of Pain and the Batrider. And Scant has had his PC crash, so we'll try and get him back into the game as quickly as we possibly can. And in the meantime, let's take a quick look. Is anyone ahead significantly? About 3,000 net worth lead for VG. But again, this comes down to their laning stage. Everything went pretty nicely the first 5 minutes or so before that first nighttime really kicked into play with the Nightstalker running himself around. As actually, speaking of, Syla is silenced up here. He's going to get lassoed, and this chain stun is perfect from FTD. Takes out the poor little Lifestealer. CTY jumps forward, there's a Dream Claw down after two, but he's walking up high ground into the solid side of DXM. RGK and Inferno played onto another one as well. Pretty Hall, the Vengeful Squirt turns back to stun at the CTY. But there's the Oracle, Force Promise. Keeps the pack alive for now, they just need to stun him up and keep him on lockdown, but he blinks himself away. Jumps out the Sonic Wave. Was that dodge? He's gonna die, he drops now to the Force Promise, but HYM is shot back into death. FTDB, three kills for the price of nothing. They can't get Roshan just yet, but they'll look for this tier 1 middle lane and they will claim it. What a fight for them, starting off with a kill on Syla. 2,500 net worth swing there. Exchange of gold, money in the hands of FTB, FTD even. There's Batrider, enough money for Blink on top of Travels and Bottle, Quip Pain. Not sure what she's buying into there. Yule Scepter against the Puck is a likely one for her. Lincoln Sphere is not bad here though against the Lion and the Doom, especially Burning with the Hex available. You have to be a little bit worried about exactly how the Lion's going to initiate onto you. Let's see if we can get Scant back into the casting seat. Let's get him in here. Maybe not. Lifestealer. Granite Golem for him, and the rest of his team is smoking up, actually. Double scan, looking into this dire jungle. Excellent. The person who you're trying to reach is currently resting in peace. Rip Scant. Press F to pay respects. Hopefully we'll get him back sooner rather than later, though. So Lifestealer, Ancient Granite Golem, gonna go around punching creeps. And still roaming themselves around, but Ram, he's hiding away in these trees. This orb might give away his position, actually. They know the Spirit Bear's here, but they don't know where the hero is. And CTY won't go hunting, diving into the trees to look for him. Well, maybe now it's time for FTD to smoke up. They've found the Lifestealer, but Killix Ancient is almost an impossibility. It's so bloody tanky. 2,000 HP, 8 armor, and the lack of physical damage here from FTD is definitely going to start showing at this stage. Radiant's top tower is under attack. Come on, Scant. Get your South African butt back in here. Well, ping. This is what we were saying. He's gone for small incremental items. Iron Talon obviously helps you farm relatively easily. Getting straight into the Aghanim Scepter here, and with the Batrider Nightstalker combination, as we get further into this game, 20, 25 minutes in, and get that combination up. I've just got the perfect vision and perfect initiation tools to maybe catch one of these key heroes from VG, but Burning, he's got a different kind of catching on his mind. He wants to catch a bear. Spirit Bear will get jumped back to the hero, and Burning won't be able to find anything. Well, bot lane, the push is actually quelled. Firefly, the help of Wave of Terror here from the Vengeful Spirit, enough to push back the couple of heroes from VG. Well, CTY waiting for that 16-minute rune. Where's Sylar? Where is Sylar? Oh, he's still in the lion. I know he's there, though. They've got the knowledge, they've got the intel. Burning jumps forward, but he's not going to catch anyone in this area. Pretty Whore and FTD, they're all spread out pretty nicely. Queen of Paint, and she decided what she's heading into. Could be the Yule Scepter. RTK, Force Promise back onto him, but the swap back. This should secure the kill here as Triple S comes in to try and snipe it out. RTK healed up a hell of a lot through Scorched Earth and the Force Promise. But regardless, FTD will find the pick. And VG, maybe crumbling a little bit here. As they are trying to spread the map and farm up as much as they possibly can, but CTY cannot kill this lone druid on his own. 3,500 gold saved up for Ram. That relic is getting bloody close. It's going to be a very quick Radiance unless he gets sniped off here. And with the help of Burning, they've got the stuns and the nuke damage to kill off the lone druid. Helped out, of course, by the double damage rune here with the puck. And there's your question answered there. Yule Scepter for the Queen of Pain. Not the Lincolns, not the Hex. Going for the super aggressive or super defensive builds, but instead going for a bit of a middle of the road build there as he just walks straight into the creep wave. Doesn't give a shit about Sylar's Lone Lycan. Oh my god. Lifestealer. For some reason, my brain, Lone Druid, Lycan, Lifestealer, all the L heroes just merge into one. There we go. Thank you very much, brain. You bloody idiot. Four-man group up though. RNGK not available, still down at bottom lane. I don't have that Doom available, but they do have Blink Silence from the park. The trouble is, this Yule Scepter is going to be vitally important to the Queen of Pain. Dire's middle tower is under attack. To get herself out of that one. Well, Scant said he shouldn't be too long now. Get ourselves in now. Where are Sylar's items? So he got the Armlet Phase move very quickly in, like 13 minutes or so. But progressing on after that has slowed down significantly now as he's sitting on a Sanj on top of his armlet. Have to get that SNY up and running. That's a little armlet animation there. The purple farts. Puck, got a bit of a gas problem. Jumping in a little bit further forward. I'll take down this tier 2 tower. But at this point, it's all the waiting game for FTD. They want this Radiance on the bear, so they've got to try and safeguard him. This positioning of the two supports, you can see that very clearly. Venge and Nightstalker creating this barricade all around the lone druid, even though there's a Radiant Observer Ward there scouting out and seeing exactly what he's up to. Well, Triple S as well as DXM. Pretty nicely pushing out these other lanes, mid and bottom. Shoved in very hard. And VG, they've got to respect this. They have to respond. They have to do something and address what FTD are doing. Is that Relic done? Relic, Midas off cooldown. Sylar, you may be a Lifestealer, but you've got a hell to pay up against this lone druid. These entangles could definitely catch you. Well, Batrider. Getting to that. All staff after the BOTs and Blink. It's all very well timed here for FTD. I just need to make sure they don't get killed or picked off, and DXM with his Invis rune nearly walking into the range of that sentry, and maybe walking into the arms of Burning, but I'll look towards mid now. aiming to pick a fight. This is going to be a scrappy one if they do choose to jump in here. Silo's up on the front lines. They've got the Oracle behind. Got CTY now looking to get up in front though. Lifestealer infested and FTD, they all bail themselves away. And the Batrider still actually invis up on his high ground, waiting for his moment to strike, getting ready to jump himself in. But FTD, not falling for it. Daytime hits, 20 minutes in, there's no darkness. The VG, they will regroup. Oh, there we go. Second nighttime, third nighttime, millionth nighttime. And Scant has returned.
Hello, I'm sorry about that. I don't know. We have some bad luck when I cast a D, my computer decides to crash, but it looks like there's about to be a fight right now.
Yeah, we're cursed. I jump in, Lone Druid and Vengeful Spirit in the Dream Core. This is too deep in behind the tier 3, with the Nightstalker having darkness here. They've got to retreat, and there's the entire hill to RGK. Savage Roar into stun, even with a false promise there. It's unlikely he'll be able to escape this. Oh, where's the Blink Dagger? Where's the Blink Web Bang? Gonna jump himself forward, lasso off someone. RGK's caught now, he's healed up to half HP, but in comes the Sonic Wave across the front of a bunch of them, but Sylar ripping through one after the other. Those are pretty well now. The Rage of Ingrid Death kills off the Vengeful Spirit with Entangle. The Bear catches Sylar, but they don't have enough damage. They can't actually keep up with him. Sylar just lurched him way too much back from the Spirit Bear. And CTY, he started things off with a pretty dodgy jump in, deep into tier 3 territory, but they still kill off a couple of orcs. I'm just not entirely certain this was all worth it. With Lone Druid still alive and getting very quickly into that Radiance, he's going to be a force to be reckoned with in a matter of minutes.
It's a tricky thing, and it's funny because I was gone for a while, but what I was talking about right before I left is if they can handle the Lifestealer. And look, they've got Venge, they've got Quaff, which can blink away, Nightstalker run fast. They have potential to kite the Lifestealer, but in terms of fighting and killing the Lifestealer, it's going to be difficult for them for quite a long time. And Lone Druid, yeah, it's great physical damage, you got the Entangle, but the problem is the Lifestealer turns around and just attacks the Spirit Bear, and suddenly your physical damage goes away. So I'm not sure. I feel like that's the linchpin of this game. Going forward, as the game gets decided later on in fights, it's going to be about how much the Lifestealer gets done, if they control the Lifestealer, if they kill the Lifestealer, if they kite it, or if it's just like terrorizing them. And something people forget, because recently with all of the hype about Lifestealer getting an Ancients, all that stuff, is that this, I think really the major strength of this hero is that you have a built-in 6-second BKB that also gives you attack speed. And that's like, the reason the Chinese teams always favor this hero is exactly that. That once the fighting starts, you didn't spend 4,000 gold on a BKB, you just have it anyway. And a lot of the time at this stage in the game, teams to deal with the carry want to be able to stun or slow or something like that. And if the rage is well timed, you just can't do that.
It's definitely difficult. So this is why VG, I feel they need to get the upper hand in these team fights and jump in with the Lifestealer bombs and make sure they get on top of these key heroes like the Batrider, maybe the Vengeful Spirit in the back end. But FTD, they're the ones actually on the aggressive here. Nighttime, maybe ending soon. They want to try and utilize it as best they can with the orb already thrown by CTY. They just need the vision. Aghanim Scepter for Nightstalker. I think it saw the smoke, and Batrider jumps forward, pops it out, and catches the Oracle Dragon back with the Doom not thrown out. The Sarge back and playing onto the Doom and the Sonic Wave! Across three of them! They've caught them! VG ripped to shreds as the Sarge jumps out, finally does some damage to Savage back, burning is now entangled up. And FTDB, one after the other, they're gonna find kill after kill. Can CTY escape from this one? He blinks the orbs, he jumps himself back a little bit further, but he's juked! He's juked into the trees! He's hiding! He's TPing! Entangle stun caught with the Orb Scepter! He's not gonna get out of this one, is he? Phase shift, blink in 3 seconds time. The magic wand and orb as well. He's gonna try to get himself away. There's a self yours. And now the blink. Get himself away. The phase shift is there as well. Come on, CTY. Can you really do this? Jump now. Get yourself a little bit further back, but there's no escape from the Batrider. Fire flies over the trees, and Queen of Pain, ready with a scream, to finish off the CTY Park.
Yeah, so this is the kind of fight that FTD will always win, because they target the squishy heroes first, they catch the Oracle, which is what it's supposed to save on the bat, and then they just kite the Lifestealer a bit, until the point that, you know, Sylo uses Rage, runs in, oh, I can't do anything, needs to run away. Like, that's the worst kind of fight for VG Gaming, because as much as I talk about the value of Lifestealer having the built-in BKB, when the Rage is on cooldown, the hero is actually very easy to deal with, very easy to control, even kill. So Vici Gaming have pressure on them to get the initiation they want and have the fight start the way they want, and that was the furthest from that. And to be honest, with the Nightstalker Aghanims, anytime it's nighttime, I just feel like this game is very difficult for Vici Gaming. Like, how they're supposed to manufacture that kind of fight their ones when the enemy team has a Nightstalker Axe, and they don't have... typically when we see teams with like big Vision Hero, the other team has some kind of Vision Hero as well, but I think the Nightstalker, am I right, was the last pick of the draft this game?
Yes.
So there wasn't really opportunity for Vici to go, oh, you've got a Nightstalker, we'll get a Beastmaster or Bounty Hunter or a Spirit Break or
and
one of those other...
I believe Beastmaster and Bounty were both first phase banned as well.
Yeah. So it's... I mean, those the normal kinds of heroes were out. I mean, there could still be a Zeus or some of these Venno forwards, but the point is if you take this late, and even Venge gives some vision ability, Batrider, you could consider the Lone Druid in terms of scouting the Spirit Bear forward, so... That's a troubling consideration if we look at the fact that we're saying that depending on who gets the initiation and how the fight starts, that's going to be very important in this game, that the one team has so much better vision than the other team.
The biggest surprise for me so far is that Roshan has not been attempted yet. The big man is still sitting in his basement waiting for someone to come knock on his door and ask for a cup of sugar. But neither of these teams seem too interested, which I feel like VG should be interested. They want to fight, they want to push high ground, and I guess the fact they haven't won a significant fight near or around the Rosh Pit hasn't enabled them to get in there, but regardless, we're going to see the jump in from FTD soon. With Darkness popped, Ping runs forward, and just wants to hunt, scout, give vision, and give that knowledge across to the rest of his team, and I think I've seen CTY, the blink forward, there's the jump, but there's no lasso. CTY was a little bit too far away there for DXM to catch him. And FTD, I'll keep their tier 2 alive. Also, I'll secure this area around Roshan now. Well, VG, they're grouping up. They need to fight. They need to go and run at FTD here to try and gain and leverage some kind of advantage so they can push into objectives.
Do they have another smoke? No, I don't think they do. I feel like maybe the plan is they baited Nightstalker ulti, and when his ulti ends, like, there's still some time before real night starts again. And if that's right, that's like the window. We'll see now. His ulti is about to end. And yeah, it's still daytime for quite a while. His ulti is another minute. This is the window for VG Gaming. Like, they really have to try and abuse this window. They've got like a minute and a half, or really a bit less than that, where I don't think FTD wants to fight them at all, because they definitely don't want to operate without that night time.
Well, they've got Blink on Doom, they've got the Infest into the POC at ready and available again. The full staff of Burning is over in the stash.
Is there enough time to rush? That's the question. I think
with
there is.
Death Soul and Lifestealer? I think there is.
Yeah, you'd have to contest without your night time if you're FTD.
It looks like they'll be planning to with the smoke. FTD, they're desperate to get themselves into this Rosh Pit. It's on half HP into the open wounds, healing everyone up from VG. Roshan is pretty much already dead. A triple S, TXM, gonna try and get yourself into the pit, but Roshan knows there's no steel. He will have a pop just for two man stones. For the green player, for the metal triple S as well, and they're just dead. That is absolutely fucked. Two of them, the big core heroes, Bat and Queen of Pain, up and he's gonna be the third one as well, taken out of the game. And FTD, they thought they could contest Roshan against VG, but against CTY Puck, you've got another thing coming, mates.
You know what, I don't even know if they thought to themselves, can we contest? Yes, we can. I think they just felt they needed to, and the sad thing is that it's absolutely about the Nightstalker not having night time. It wasn't normal night, he'd already used his ulti. It was smart of VG to go back when he used his ulti before, but now we have a situation where Nightstalker has the ulti up and they're still managing to get power, maybe even racks here.
Or maybe the bear. Holy shit, look at the bear!
Okay, so this is... I mean, if Spirit Bear needs to be very careful now about running in, you don't just run in and radiance people if there's no resummon. That means the Raxes go down and this entire window's open. I feel like if you're FTD, you just say it's fine. You know, get rush. We'll wait till nighttime, and even with the Aegis, we still be at advantage, but trying to contest when they don't have the normal vision control that they have really, really backfired there, and they've given Vici a huge opening into this game.
Oh, for sure. I mean, still having that Aegis available as well in your Lifestealer means that he can walk up to high ground with impunity pretty much and hit these tier 3s. It's just a matter of setting lane equilibrium to where VG wants it. Push out top lane to somewhere along this area here, get mid lane shoved in, and bot lane has to be addressed by FTD. They have to kind of push this one out and make sure the creeps aren't entering their base. And that's why Triple S, he's got his Axe and his Yule Scepter. Spending out that Sonic Wave is well worth it just to clear out these creep waves and try and levy the momentum away from VG. Even the smallest factors can help.
Yeah, and FTD just needs to, I really think they need to be more careful about their knight usages now. They need to make sure that they get value out of the, when, I mean, only if there's a very few times. I think each daytime, there's going to be one time the Night Stalker ulti is that after it finishes, there's still a chunk of daytime. The rest of the time, it's almost always night. That's just how the zero works between your ulti and the regular clock. But they have to be very careful about that one important daytime Night Stalker ulti usage that they do something with it, because they'll know now that Vici Gaming are absolutely fully ready to punish those windows.
Night Stalker has a gem now. Oh, ROTK, he just has a smoke pop, so they jump forward. He's looking for the Dream, he's going to BKB up as well. He's doing the Night Stalker though, that's not the best of times. From the Dream Pulse, two ultis extended on the Night Stalker. Ping, we're landed into the ground here by Sylar, and finished off by Burning.
It's alright,
FTD.
I mean, I've been talking so much about the importance of Night Stalker ulti and vision and that. If he's dead, that's, it might as well be day, right?
Did they get the gem from him as well? CTY has the gem now, so there's no gem Night Stalker available, and they'll just walk up 2 minutes until Aegis is taken back, and Sylar making short work of this tier 3 tower, making it look so easy. Maybe even looking for the spirit there as well if it gets too close in, but there's a swap into lasso players. Well done by FTD, but what can they do to follow through? The boss promise is there as well, but the healer's coming on to hit the Sonic Wave to try and finish off Sylar, but he still has Aegis the Immortal. Sylar will drop low from this, maybe even just burn out. No, he's not, he's gonna heal himself up. So much heal coming out of the daycon and the zap out from CTY. The Queen of Pain drops, and they're gonna keep on chasing. Looking for tier 4s? Nah, they'll finish off the Rax. They came here for a job, and they'll finish off the Spirit Bear. 1, 2, 3, chunk down. And now, taken out of the game by the final Purifying Flames. The Burning Force left himself away. Sylar, he is in no man's land here. Deep in behind him, relying for this talk at the Aegis of the Immortal, remember. He has a secondary life, and then a minute and a half left in that one. RG does not have the same luxury, though. Finally working down there to the left, but there's the Savage Roar. Not going through that nice little magic beauty of Lion Stealer. And one by one, FTDB, they are being absolutely demolished by Sylar's Lifestealer. GG is called. It's over. They can't touch him.
Yeah, we saw one of the combos there, the False Promise plus Lifestealer Feast, like the number of hits he gets off, and he's just 4 HP, even though he was like red HP before the False Promise. It was an interesting interaction there, where I felt like the Lifestealer Feast wasn't dealing damage. I feel like he wasn't dealing damage to the Spirit Bear during the Oracle ulti. I don't know, it just felt like the Spirit Bear wasn't taking any damage at that stage. Maybe it's because he was under the towers with like lots of bonus armor at that stage, but Vici Gaming, out of nowhere, a game that was pretty close, if anything I think we both thought was favouring FTD up until that rush, just blown out of, I mean, what, like less than 10 minutes from dead even to 50.